Now the coffee's hit. Good morning. It's so great to be here in front of such a like-minded audience. It's really amazing to see a full house. Well done to the organisers. This is really amazing. So I have been challenged with talking about what technology can do to prevent or save our species. So ordinarily, I would like to go into huge detail, but instead I'm going to bring you on a very whistle-stop tour of current technologies, current limitations, but also some of the most futuristic technologies that might be used in the not-so-distant future. Next slide, please. Oh, I have it. Thank you. I just wanted them to do it for me, keep them awake. So I'm Dr. Helen O'Neill, and I'm a CEO and founder of Hertility Health. So this is something, as a health tech founder, I ask myself quite a lot about the decline of human fertility. Can technology save us? But as a lecturer in reproductive and molecular genetics, this is something that I've asked for a much longer question. I'm nearly 9 years lecturing in reproductive and molecular genetics at University College London, just around the corner at the Institute for Women's Health. And from an academic perspective, there are many more things that we have to take into account when trying to answer, can we save future fertility? So it doesn't really take an expert to look at this graph and not see that global fertility rates are declining significantly, and to ask ourselves, what is it that we can do to prevent this? And it might be quicker to rush to technology and say, how can technology save us, when the reality is many of the things that are actually causing the global fertility decline are societal shifts. And so we can't change society necessarily through technology. So it's really important to look at all of the different elements that we might be able to take into account when really building technology that suits this. We have to think about society, we have to think about the individual, all of the points that Amy has just pointed to when it comes to our future woman. So when we look at this decline, even though you might say there's 8 billion of us on the planet, why it's important is because the replacement rate is a very important metric in global economics. Unless we have more babies born than people die, there aren't enough people to replace those. And so we end up with countries like Japan, where more nappies were sold for old people last year than there were for babies. And so there's not enough of a workforce to take over and drive forward a sustainable and growing economy. But in order to fix or build technology around fertility, we first have to understand what is fertility, and moreover, what is infertility, and understand that it can be defined as primary infertility, whereby you cannot conceive within the first year, or secondary infertility, whereby you've already had a successful pregnancy and family and are unable to achieve a second. One in three people will exit their fertile years with fewer children than planned. And when you look at some of these statistics, we've now actually only in April seen that the World Health Organization produced a report that now one in six globally are infertile. That's actually a crazy metric to think how many people are affected by what we would call a silent epidemic. People are still not talking about fertility and moreover, infertility. And what we emphasize is that this is a female factor role. And so the emphasis and burden and therefore blame can often be on women, as opposed to this being both parties and both parties to blame. But what we wanted to build when we built Hertility was a better understanding of fertility and infertility, and to take into account all of the different things that might impact somebody's fertility. So when you look up all of the different female factors that could cause infertility, there are 11 different listed reasons. Here are just some of them. On the NIH website, from uterine to chromosomal to ovarian to menstrual, there are many different factors that can cause female infertility. And so creating a one-size-fits-all approach or creating a solution that doesn't tailor to the many different causes for female infertility means that you don't come up with a solution for the many people who are affected. Now, you'd like to think that some of these are rare, but actually so many of these conditions and reasons for infertility are so prevalent within our demographic. And because the symptoms of many of these are very insidious, many of the symptoms of hormone imbalance are feeling tired, not being able to lose weight, feeling hungry or angry. Who doesn't feel angry and hungry and a little bit fat all of the time? I think it's our most common symptom is just fatigue and anxiety. So you have to take into account many different factors in terms of the physiological, anatomical, but also genetic elements that individual people bring when it comes to that question, am I fertile? So when I was looking at the name for this event, which is Decoding the Future of Women, I thought, well, in order to decode, you first need to have data in order to do that, right? We first need to code the current female. And that's what we set out to do at Hertility, was to create a database that gave us significant information for us to build our data set, to make informed decisions about today's woman. What we were shocked to find was that in building a clinical trial that wanted to develop predictive algorithms for all of these different pathologies to give us an idea of what is an individual's risk of having infertility based on the parameters of their biometrics, symptoms, menstrual patterns, previous medical history, previous infection, all of the things that this complex calculus of events on top of a cascading hormonal change that happens cyclically, what were the things that for that individual might be a risk factor? And so in order to develop predictive algorithms for different gynecological pathologies, you first need decent data. And it really shocked us, it made us quite angry to see that the data that exists, that by the way informs current clinical practice, was based off such poor data sets. And the studies that were used to inform clinical guidelines for certain gynecological conditions, these are the international diagnostic criteria and guidelines that are used to diagnose conditions, were based off such poor data sets that we said, we need to build this from the ground up. And that's what we set to do. So in order to do this, this is the current technology that we're building. And I will say, it's pretty basic, because when it comes to fertility and reproductive health, we actually do have to go back to basics. As a molecular geneticist, it really surprised and actually enraged me to think that when we extrapolate a root cause for a genetic condition, we will interrogate the entire genome before we have a causative reason for that genetic condition. And despite that, we have cures for some of the rarest of genetic conditions. And yet when it comes to the most common of women's health conditions affecting 1 in 10, 1 in 3, we don't even have answers. And so building this data set relies on really quite a private interaction between you and a digital interface that enables you to give all of the different insights into your biometric symptoms and menstrual patterns to enable you to do a tailored at-home test. Now, I don't believe anyone should be tested for anything that they shouldn't be tested for, but I do believe that if they are triggering a potential diagnosis, we should test them for that and give them better answers. And so through this very easy clinical pathway, we're enabling somebody to get an effective triage, a tailored test, diagnosis and results, all without leaving their home. And to me, that's game-changing, and that's where we need to start. What I'm really proud to say is that we have given 314,000 women more answers about their bodies, and of the people who've done a test with us, 60% found out they had at least one hormone out of range. So many of us are walking around feeling quite subpar for all of the reasons I've just explained, these insidious symptoms that we will blame ourselves for, right? I didn't sleep well enough, I didn't go to bed, I was out on the weekend, I'm not really eating that well, or I'm working too hard. But the reality is you might be working against your body already. And so checking in on your reproductive health is a very important aspect to understanding who you are. After all, there are possibly no element of your life that isn't controlled, governed, and ruled by your hormones. Your weight, skin, mood, hair, appetite, sleep, metabolism, sex drive. Every single facet of our life is governed by these chemical messengers. And yet, many of us do track redundant metrics like steps or temperature or calories when we should be tracking our ovaries. But what about the future of reproductive technologies? Here's where we have to get really interesting. I was asked to bring my most futuristic hat, and this is what I love to do in ordinary settings, is to talk about the future technologies. So when we talk about building future technologies, really what everything that will improve that process will possibly rely around the typical process of IVF. So this is the classic journey of in vitro fertilization. It relies on an appointment, ovarian stimulation, we do some sperm preparation, some oocyte retrieval, fertilization that will happen either through IVF, where the egg is in the bowl with a whole load of lucky sperm, or ICSI, where you actually inject the sperm into the egg for fertilization. So all of these steps are currently used in clinical practice. And what's quite frustrating is that in the 40 years since IVF was started, we haven't seen an amazing increase in success rates. And why is that? Because the fundamental determinants by which we need to have a successful round of IVF are a healthy egg and a healthy sperm. And so often we look to technology to improve things when it's basic biological function that we need to address first. So what are the things that we might do to improve this process? So there's many different aspects along each of these journeys, and there's different technologies that are trying to automate some of these processes as well. But we could also look to how we might prevent genetic disorders and prevent the things that are causing infertility. After all, when it comes to genetic causes of infertility, maybe we could look to the sperm or the egg or the embryo and say, let's make sure we correct that mutation, and let's make sure we don't pass it on to the next generation. A lot of infertility is inherited from your parents. So along that exact process that I just spoke about, sperm prep, oocyte retrieval, IVF or ICSI, embryo culture and embryo transfer, nothing would really change if we were to introduce genome editing to this journey. You might be surprised to say that if we were to edit the genome of an embryo or edit our genomes throughout history, you might think it's a much more different process. But this was actually done for the first time 4 years ago now in Hong Kong, which was not a good time for anyone to do this. It was far too premature. But essentially, when asked at the time, are you sure he did it? I was very sure he did it because of the ease of this process, whereby at the exact point where you're injecting that sperm to cause fertilization, you could also introduce your genome editing components in CRISPR. So sometimes future technologies can seem very futuristic, but their application is just an adaptation of current technologies. But when we don't have enough sperm or egg, we're seeing a global shortage of sperm and a global shortage of donor eggs because the main societal problem is we are waiting too late. So what if IVF doesn't work because you don't have enough eggs or you can't find a donor sperm? Well, now there are technologies and labs all over the world that are looking at ways that we could generate sperms and egg cells from our skin. So how it might work is that you would take a skin cell, you would re-derive it to make it pluripotent again, so you can give it these factors called Yamanaka factors, and you make it essentially young again. And so when you put those young cells or young stem cells in the environment or the niche of other cells that it's meant to be, so let's say we put this sperm cell back in the testicular niche, it will form new sperm cells. So what we're seeing here is that actually maybe we might be able to actually recreate sperm and eggs in the dish. And this was recently done, and it was covered in the BBC in March. What you'll see here is the scientist who managed to create that. You'll see next to him the scientist who was very happy to be talking to him. I have no idea why they didn't crop me out of this photo, other than the sheer delight that is on my face as I cling to this apple. They did say, could you move out of the way for the photo? And I did. And they still got me looking very jolly. It's kind of weirdly Adam and Eve that I'm holding this forbidden fruit. Nonetheless, we are making great strides into creation of new technologies that support assisted reproduction. So what about even further into the future? And this might seem utterly futuristic, and we saw a very sensational headline where we would see ectogenesis and babies created outside of the womb. And again, people like to think of these things as being, we're going to be defunct and we're going to be taking over. But really, these solutions were being built for very premature babies. So babies that were born premature to give them additional support and life for the remaining few weeks. So actually, sometimes we can look at technologies and say, this is one step too far. But everything in context and for its actual purpose means maybe this could support the growing need for premature babies in the world. Okay. If we go back to reality and talk about current reproductive technologies, where do most people go for solutions? I had the benefit of sitting next to the president of Google, EMEA. That sounds like a fake job. It's like the Wizard of Oz. But I sat next to Matt Britton, who's the president of Google, and he said, you could help billions of women. How can we help you? So he very kindly brought us into the Google headquarters and gave us a team of Googlers to help us find what were people actually searching for so that we could meet them in the middle. And unfortunately, one of the most searched questions was, what is fertility? And that was a very stark moment for us to realize that actually we need to go back to very, very basics. And there is so much education that needs to happen. If we are to improve future fertility, it starts at a much earlier age and it starts at a much earlier conversation by answering, what is fertility? We have enabled this through our test at Hertility, where we enable precision diagnostics through an interface, as I mentioned, through telemedicine. And what's incredible about this interface is that we ask many questions. We have internally embedded algorithms that help us to determine your relative risk of over 18 different gynecological pathologies. These are the most common gynae pathologies that there are. And these embedded algorithms essentially are based off international diagnostic criteria and guidelines that are used to already diagnose these conditions. And what we've learned through this health assessment, if anyone hasn't done it, do the health assessment. You'll find out answers about yourself even through the health assessment. What we've learned is that the conversations that we're not having with women are centered around lifestyle and drinking, drug taking. So 40% of women who are actively trying to conceive are drinking alcohol, and 10% of them are drinking way above the national limit. So there's a conversation that we need better informed discussions about these things. 8% are actually taking drugs while trying to conceive. So I don't think those are truth conversations that you'll ever have with your practitioner if you sat in front and they said, any drugs? Not today. Do you have any? And so it gives us actually a really great starting point for how we can start these conversations. What are the basic steps that we can do to maybe reduce fertility from 1 in 6 to 1 in 100? And one of our missions is to just meet people on the street. We literally did a billboard campaign where we met people and we took over the stations. We called them ovulation stations. And we hoped that everyone would take the fallopian tube to work. And we educated people. We had conversations. And this was the most incredible experience to bring us to the individuals, to have people approach us about what we are doing and how we can better inform people about their bodies. And here's some of the other examples of what of the messages that we gave. The Fempire Strikes Back was one that we knew the men would pay attention to. But moreover, we actually published our results in something that wasn't just a scientific journal. We presented so many of our data at conferences. I did 5 talks in one day at one conference. And then I realized these aren't the audience that need to hear this. I'm preaching to the converted. So we created a guide, which essentially was based off 4 pillars for reproductive health to better inform people about the results that we found within our data set, to share with the people who gave us their information what those demographics and what those data points were. And I would love if anyone was interested to download this reproductive guide. So I'm just going to take a minute to end with our brand movie, if it can be played.
This is a woman. She has a body. Her body has been revered for millennia, but never studied properly. Ever. Not like men's bodies, not by medicine, not by science. Her body is too mysterious, too complex, too hormonal. In pain? Pain is normal. Oh, it really hurts. Take a pill. Irregular periods? Go on the pill. Your periods have stopped? Try a different pill. Want a baby? You're too young to worry about fertility. Have fun. Any babies yet? Don't wait too long. Still trying. Silly girl, you left it too late. Were you having too much fun? Just relax. Have you tried not thinking about it? Frustrated? Don't cry. Why are you so angry? Time of the month? Ooh, someone's hormonal. Yes, I am hormonal. We're all hormonal. Our hormones keep us alive. They make us feel alive. They allow us to create life. Our hormones, they impact our stress, our skin, our weight, our emotions, our whole bodies. Yet we know so little about them. Now is our time. Time to demystify our bodies. Time to know exactly what's happening under our skin. Time to get answers backed by science, not just hope. Fertility. Science. Meet life.
I'm Dr. O'Neill. My name is Rumbi. I'm a doctor within the NHS, and I agree with you that we do need more research upon women's health. Now, I saw you wrote that, you know, through the stuff that you found, 82% of women suffer from hormonal imbalance. And my worry is, are we now overdiagnosing? Are we finding problems that would, you know, let's say we do this test and I'm just curious about my hormone levels. I now have low estrogen, let's say. I now have this information, which may never have impacted my life, but now I have the information, I go down a rabbit hole. Could it potentially cause harm, be it psychological harm, as opposed to benefit as well?
So that is the type of mentality I totally disagree with, because what it does is it assumes that we are these mindless beings that are completely out of touch with our bodies. And we ask a significant number of details about whether you've ever had any diagnosis, whether you have any symptoms, and people know when there's something wrong. So one of the questions that we ask is, have you ever been diagnosed with any of the following? And we list polycystic ovary syndrome, hypothyroidism, anything to do with hormones and physiological health as well. And then we have a little box at the end that says, no, but I suspect something's up. And when somebody ticks that box, in 90% of cases, they are absolutely right and there's something wrong. And it shows you, if you were to go to a primary care provider and say, something's not up, they wouldn't know where to start. You might get laughed at and you certainly would be more likely to be dismissed with something so intangible as, I don't feel right. And yet, innately, we do know our bodies. And innately, when we have a monthly cycle that is either irregular or regular, we know when things are wrong. So until now, we've never had an outlet to just better understand. We've never had an ability to say, what are the things? If somebody just was to do a routine test and get blood results, I couldn't agree more. We never, ever want to give people blood results. What we wanted to give people, and that's why it's taken us so long to build this, is an extrapolation of what their blood results in combination with each other and in combination with their lifestyle factors, their biometrics, their symptoms, their menstrual patterns, all actually mean in combination with each other. Hence why we've coded 54,000 clinical scenarios to give somebody a better idea of what, A, what it all means, but B, what are the, we spent an additional 2 years building on the actionable insights. Many different things we can do if you do have a hormone imbalance can be altered through simple lifestyle adjustments and dietary changes. So those are the pieces of information that if you don't provide, then I agree, you might end up a little bit spiraling. But actually, most people come to us, and even when they get a diagnosis, had somebody come up to me at the Women in Data event, and she said, can I hug you? I spent 5 years looking for a diagnosis, and I got a diagnosis of PCOS. And I shouldn't be so delighted, but I finally have answers about what all of this means, and I don't have to blame myself. Most people are entirely grateful to have an answer about their body that they always knew wasn't quite right.
Thank you.